done. Save, save, save. Let's stand together to sing it. Brother Bob's going to lead us 431.
I found a friend who is all to me. His love is ever true. I love to tell how he lifted me and what his grace can do for you. Saved by his power divine, saved to new life sublime. Life now is sweet and my joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved, saved. He saved me from every sin and harm, secures my soul each day. I'm leaning strong on his mighty arm. I know he'll guide me all the way. Saved by his power divine,
saved to life
sublime. Life now is sweet and my joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved, saved. When poor and needy and all alone, in love he said to me, come unto me and I'll lead you home to live with me eternally. Saved by his power divine, I'm saved to new life sublime. Life now is sweet and my joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved, saved. Saved by his power divine, I'm saved to new life sublime. Life now is sweet and my joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved, saved.
Man, that's good, isn't it? Aren't you glad you're saved? You know, you're in the minority in the world that can sing that and mean it from their heart. And thank God I'm saved. And looking forward to a great service together tonight. Thanks for being back on Sunday night. And for the church service, we're going to have a delightful time together this evening and appreciate you being here. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we thank you for another service to come together. Thank you, Lord, for each one who's made their way here tonight. And Father, we bow before you this evening. We want to thank you and praise your name that we can sing, we're saved, because we're saved by your power divine. And Lord, we're saved because of what you have done for us. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for dying on the cross for our sins, for rising again the third day, and that you're a living Savior. And you're able to save all those that come unto God by you. And so, Lord, we love you tonight. We thank you for the privilege to be here. Speak to us tonight. Use the service. May it be an encouragement. May it be a blessing. Just may it be exactly what you know that each of us needed to be in our heart and that you would use it in our lives for your honor and glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Would you turn with me to number 334? 334, still sweeter every day. To Jesus every day I find my heart is closer drawn. To Jesus every day I find my heart is closer drawn. Then the glory of the gold and purple dawn. He's all my fancy pictures in his fairest dreams and more. Each day he grows still sweeter than he was the day before. The half cannot be fancy, this side the golden shore. Oh, there he'll be still sweeter than he ever was before. His glory broke upon me when I saw him from afar. He's fairer than the lily, brighter than the morning star. He fills and satisfies my longing spirit o'er and o'er. He was before. My heart is sometimes heavy, but he comes with sweet relief. He folds me to his bosom when I droop with blight and grief. I love the Christ who all my burdens in his body bore. Each day he grows so sweeter than he was the day before. The half cannot be fancied, this side the golden shore. Oh, there'll be still sweeter than he ever was before.
All right. Now, some announcements and schedule this week, of course. Stay around after the service tonight. We'll be unveiling our theme and giving you the calendar, the pen for the new year and such, and then have some fellowship. And you want to see the slides from 2016. We got several hundred of them, and there's some you won't want to miss, I'll guarantee it. And so we'll have a great time with fellowship and food and reviewing 2016, all right, and got some great things to share with you about that, okay? And then, of course, Wednesday night, midweek service right here, 7 o'clock in the auditorium, and the Bible clubs will be meeting, of course, as usual, and we'll get right back into it, and then the regular schedule throughout the rest of the week, and then, of course, next Sunday services, everything back to normal, whatever normal is, it'll be back to normal on Sunday, okay? Saturday evening is the workers' dinner and meeting, and we meet at 5 o'clock in the fellowship hall. If you're involved in ministry at all, then you ought to be there, and we expect you to be there. And if you're not involved and you'd like to be involved and you ought to be involved, then you come and get signed up and come on out and be here for that night. If you sign up, it helps you to us to know how to prepare and have things ready for you, provide a meal for you that night, and then we have a meeting. We come in here for our meeting portion of it, and we will have a program for the children. And so plan on that if you would, and we'll take care of them during our session here. They can eat with us, and then we'll have a program for them as well, okay? And remember the fellows who are going to help take down the decorations, that you can do that this evening. You can do it after our fellowship or whenever that time is. That's no problem with that. We'll get all the totes in here, and they'll be marked appropriately for you to know what goes in what tote, okay? And that will be good. All righty. And Grove City School of the Bible, he's getting the material ordered this coming week. And so if you haven't signed up yet, make sure you get your name on the list downstairs. The classes are great. Teaching the Bible, the Christian Home, and Survey of the New Testament 1. All right. And so those are great courses. I think it's $25 for the class is all it is. $25 for each. If you take all three, it's $60. So you get a great discount on that. So if you want to sign up, get signed up down there. Brother Morton's going to order that material. We want to make sure that we get enough for everybody who wants to take the class. Okay? All right. Any visitors here this evening? Anybody here tonight for the very first time? Leland? All right. Who do you have here? Dale Roberts. All right. Dale, good to have you tonight. I'm sorry? You're Hudson. How did I get Dale out of that? You call him Dale, and he calls himself Hudson. Ah. Dale Hudson. Hudson Dale. It's good to have you tonight. Okay? Thank you for being here. Glad you brought your friend, Leland. All right. Is there anyone else? All right. If you'll be kind enough to fill out the card for us like you're doing right now, we appreciate you doing that. In a little bit, we have the offering, and you just drop that card in the plate if you would. And we'll have a record of your visit with us this evening, all right? Let's give this gentleman a warm welcome, shall we?
Let's go to hymn number 11. Number 11, He is Mine. Long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. Number 11, let's sing that first together. Long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He exchanged the sinner for the sinless one. Jesus left his throne on high, came to earth to bleed and die. He said, Father, not my will, but thine be done. let's go over to 492. 492. Did you find that? Would you stand with me as we sing? Jesus Christ has made to me all I need. All I need. 492 on that first. Jesus Christ has made to me all I need. All I need. He alone is all my plea. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness is very hard. My redemption, full and free, He is all I need. He redeemed me when He died. All I need, all I need. I with Him was crucified. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness is very hard. My redemption, full and free, He is all I need. Ladies, sing that third together. He's the treasure. Together now, wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness is very hard. My redemption, full and free, He is all I need. Man, let's sing that forth. Jesus is my all. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. wisdom, righteousness, and power. Holiness is very hard. My redemption full and free, He is all I need. Glory, glory to the Lamb, all I need. All I need. Let's sing that last together. Glory, glory to the Lamb. All I need, all I need. By His Spirit sealed I am. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power. Holiness, this very
you can be seated. Great singing tonight. Wonderful. Ushers are coming, I think, and get the offering. They can work their way through the crowd. All right. Well, you all get here eventually. That's nice. I appreciate that. All right. Let's pray for our offering tonight, shall we? Father, thank you for the privilege to give, and thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us and for how you take care of us and provide for us. Lord, bless the giving tonight. May it take care of the needs of the work of God in this place, the ministries that you've entrusted to us, and for the furtherance of the gospel, not only here in our area, but throughout the world through our missionaries. May you bless the giver and the gift tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Take your Bible this evening, if you would, please. I'd like you to 2 Peter chapter 3, please. 2 Peter chapter 3 for our scripture reading. We're going to read verses 8 through 14. Verses 8 through 14, reading them responsively as we normally do. We'll begin together on 8 and I'll read 9, alternate until we end together on verse number 14 of 2 Peter chapter 3. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 8, 2 Peter chapter 3. Ready? But, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as a thousand years, and a thousand years as one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is longsuffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation, and godliness, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens, being on fire, shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for a new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing to the reading of the scripture now this evening. I want to thank you again, Lord, for the word of God. And Lord, what a blessing it is to have a Bible. Lord, a Bible in our language that we can read and we can study and memorize and meditate upon and proclaim, preach and study and teach. Lord, we're asking you that you use by the Holy Spirit tonight, speak to each of our hearts. We yield ourselves to you. I pray that you'll minister to us tonight as only you can. I pray you'll bless the special. Lord, draw us close to you and put us our heart in tune with your heart tonight, please. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Like a blind man I wandered, so lost and undone. A beggar, so helpless, without God or his son. Then my Savior in mercy heard and answered my cry. And oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Since Jesus passed by, since Jesus passed by, oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Well, I can't explain it, and I cannot tell you why, but oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. All my yesterdays are buried in the deepest of the sea. That old load of guilt I carried is all gone. Praise God, I'm free. Looking for that bright tomorrow where no tears will dim the eye. Well, oh, what a difference since my Jesus passed by. Since Jesus passed by, since Jesus passed by, oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Well, I can't explain it, and I cannot tell you why, but oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Is that one of the songs you like to sing along with? You want to sing that chorus with me? Since Jesus passed by, since Jesus passed by, oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Well, I can't explain it, and I cannot tell you why, but oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by.
Amen. Amen. What a difference since Jesus passed by. Amen. Great, great singing tonight. Father, we thank you now for this evening. We are truly thankful for the difference that Jesus made since he passed by. Lord, we've never been the same. And Lord, I'm asking you to pass by tonight and speak to our hearts. Go up and down these aisles and in and out of the rows and minister to each and every individual as only you can do. Lord, do what only you can do here in our midst in these next few minutes as we look into your word together. And I'll thank you for it. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You have your Bible open to 2 Peter chapter 3. How many of you ever heard the saying that We are human beings and not human doings. You ever heard that? And yet it's interesting. It's hard for us to get away from that. When someone asks, we often see somebody, we never ask, how are you being? We say, how you doing? Huh? What are you doing? How are you doing? We get up and we decide, okay, I've got to make a to-do list. And I've got to get these things done today. And it's very difficult for us to get away from being doers and do and get the emphasis on what we do. In fact, we almost identify ourselves by what we do. If someone were to ask you, just who are you? No one knew anything about you and they said, just tell me who you are. Oftentimes we start out with what we do. And you think, well, wait a minute. What if I didn't do what I did? Does that mean I wouldn't be who I am? And so we can't be identified just by what we do. It is important what we'll be. Here in 2 Peter, the Lord is emphasizing His return, that His the second coming of Christ. And if we believe what the Bible says about Jesus Christ, and we do believe what the Bible says about Jesus Christ, then we believe that He's coming again. And we know that even folks who would not profess to be Christians are talking about whether we're in the last days. They know what's going on in the Middle East. They know the attention that's being drawn to Israel right now and how not only the nations there in the Middle East, but literally with the United Nations vote a week ago, the nations of the world are turning against little Israel and going against God's chosen people. And the focus is there. And so they realize the Lord is coming. And usually the question that comes up is, even among Christian people, all right, if Jesus is coming, if this is it, if this is the last days, what are we supposed to do? But it's interesting. Here in 2 Peter, God doesn't deal with what we're supposed to do as much as He deals with, in light that Jesus is coming back, what are we supposed to be? What are we supposed to be? Notice verse number 11. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? And so, what kind of persons ought we to be? In the light that Jesus is going to return, in the light, and we'll unfold a little bit what exactly that's talking about here in the context, but what are we supposed to be? And I want to think that the Lord lays it out here for us in this passage about what we ought to be. And I'd say, number one, we ought to be witnessing for Him. We ought to be witnessing. Notice what it says in verse number 8. It says, the Lord's not slack concerning His promise. I'm sorry, verse 9. The Lord's not slack concerning His promise. Some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Because, verse number 7, it says, the heavens and the earth, which are now by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of who? Ungodly men. God says there's coming a day when ungodly men are going to be judged. There's a judgment day coming. And what are we supposed to be doing? Listen, we're going to be witnessing to others and we're going to tell them, stay away from the judgment day. You don't want to be there. When the Lord comes back in this context, when Jesus Christ returns, and the elements are going to melt away with a fervent heat. Listen, my friend, it's too late to make a decision then. Your decision will have already been made. And so if you're going to make a decision for Christ, now is the time to make the decision. Now is the time to decide for Jesus Christ. You have to make your decision now, but then it'll be too late. When it talks about the day of the Lord in this context here, it's not talking about a day, a 24-hour day. I think it's talking about a period of time. You know, we refer to that sometimes when we see something take place that's kind of odd or strange. We say, well, I'd never thought I'd see the day. You don't mean I never thought I'd see this day come. You just mean I never thought I'd see a time like this when I witnessed something like that. Okay? It's a time period that's referred to as the day of the Lord. I think it's going to encompass the tribulation period. I think it's going to encompass the millennial reign of Christ. I think it'll encompass until that's the end of the millennial reign, when Satan is let loose from the bottomless pit that he's been chained in for 1,000 years, and he'll get one final rebellion to come against Jesus Christ. But God will come, and Christ will come with him. We'll put down that rebellion, and then Satan will be bound forever in the bottomless pit with his unholy angels. Then God says there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. What's going to happen to these heavens and this earth, the Bible says. It says that, verse 10, the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with a fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are in shall be burned up. Interesting words here. And I want you to notice in verse number 10 there, it's really a fascinating verse. Notice it says the elements are going to melt with a fervent heat. The elements are the components upon which matter is divided. The letters of the alphabet are the components of which words are divided. Okay? We've had the letters make up the words. Well, the components that make up matter, there's something they're called. They're called atoms. Okay? They're called atoms. This wood here, pulpit here, is really a bunch of atoms. Now, those atoms are all held together. Can I tell you what scientists, what they tell you holds those atoms together? They don't know. We know because Colossians tells us that Christ holds it all together, that it's by him all things consist. And these atoms have tremendous heat that they put off. And he's saying these elements are going to be, the elements are literally going to melt. If they weren't held together, they were let to go, this thing would just vaporize in front of us. It would just disintegrate just like that. So with the chairs you're sitting in, so with the building we'd be in, it would just instantly be vaporized. It's an amazing thing. And when it says that they're going to melt, the word literally means to disintegrate, to break up, or to be dissolved. And I think God, all God has to do is take his hand off things. All he has to do is say, take his hand off, and everything burns up. There's no explanation scientifically as to why that doesn't happen. They don't know why it doesn't happen. It just doesn't. Well, I know why it doesn't happen, because God said he's holding it together. He's reserving that for the judgment. He's reserving that to where he's gonna allow it to be dissolved. And that's going to happen when atomic energy is released. And that happens when God takes his hand off. In fact, Peter said it up in verse 7. He said there, the heavens and the earth, by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. And so one day, God's going to release the atoms. He's going to let them go, and they're going to dissolve and be destroy, and they're going to burn things up. Everything's going to melt with a fervent heat. It's a tremendous amount of energy. It says the heavens will pass away with a great noise. Did you see that? And they tell me that that means a hissing or a crackling sound, like a rushing sound as a roar of flames. And I'm told when the atom bomb was first tested in Nevada, out in the desert, that more than one reporter said it gave a whirring or a crackling sound. And that's the atoms being released. I understand on March 9th, 1979, there were, on that day, 9 satellites stationed at various points in the solar system recorded a bizarre event deep in space. It's the most powerful burst of energy that was ever recorded. The burst of radiation lasted for 1/10 of a second. But in that instant, it emitted as much energy as the sun would emit in 3,000 years. If that burst had occurred in our galaxy, our entire atmosphere would have been set on fire. If the sun suddenly emitted that amount of energy, the earth would have been vaporized instantly. I mean, it's amazing. You can't imagine this whole world going up. You say, are you worried about preserving the earth? No, God's going to burn it up anyway. And he's got it kept in store. He's got it under his control. We're not, man thinks they're going to mess up what God's got in mind to do. We're not going to mess God up. God's not going to look and say, oh boy, what are they doing here? God's not worried about that at all, okay? He knows what he's doing. God is coming, and he's going to invade, and our job is to let people know and let people prepare people to get ready so they do not come into the judgment of God. We don't like to hear that, and people don't like to hear about judgment anymore. But God is going to judge the ungodly. There is a judgment coming. And those who do not know Christ as their Savior will be cast into hell. I know that's not popular, but that's Bible. And that's truth. And we have to come again. Listen, Christian, we have to come again face to face with. We have to understand our loved ones, our friends, our neighbors, those who we come in contact with, if they die without Jesus Christ, they will be judged and they will spend eternity in hell. Our job is to be a witness to them. We must tell them how they can know Christ as their Savior. It's time to get ready. God wants to save every single soul. He is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And all means all, and that's all means. In 2 Timothy, he said that he will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. God wants all men to come to Christ. Don't write anybody off. Don't think anybody's beyond the saving grace of God. Don't think anybody's too hard for God to save. With God, all things are possible. And God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Don't forget verse 17 when you quote verse 16. God didn't send his Son to condemn the world. But listen, if they don't believe on him, they're condemned already because they have not believed on the name of the only begotten Son of God. So turn to Christ and trust him for forgiveness. Trust him for cleansing. Or my friend, you'll be here and you'll go through the judgment of God. My friend, you'll end up eternity in hell. One thing that you have to do in these last days, if this is the last days, if this is the last time, if this is the last New Year's we'll get, I want to be a witness for Christ. I want to be a witness for him. I want to do everything I can to help people escape the horror of that day. Be witnesses. The second thing I see that he wants us to do here is verse 11. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? So I see I'm to be holy. I'm to commit myself to live a holy and a godly life. You know, I read a story about a man who said a few months ago his son barged into his bedroom in the middle of the night screaming that the neighbor's house was on fire. The man said, I jumped out of bed and ran out the front door and a blast of heat hit me. Across the street, the neighbor's house was going up in flames. He said the firemen were able to save part of their home, but they lost the living room, the kitchen, and the garage, totally destroyed. He said, I thought about some of the irreplaceable antiques I knew they had in that house that are now gone. Gone, just like that. You know, it illustrates the truth to us. Things don't last. Things can be gone, just like that. The things people put their time and money into, all their effort, can be gone, just like that. All the things that we thought were so important. And I'll guarantee you this, there'll come a day when you go, or if the Lord comes back, they're going to go. And you'll be separated from those things. Remember the rich man who said, I've got so many things, I'm not sure what I should do. I know what I'll do. I'll tear down these barns and build bigger barns. So I have more room to store all my stuff. Huh? And God said, no, you're a fool. He said, this night your soul's going to be required of you. And then he asked him a question. Remember what it was? Then who shall these things be? You're not taking them with you. You're leaving it all behind. And if you leave it behind, they're going to burn up. And that's the point. If all the stuff we think is so important to us is going to all burn up one day anyway, why are we spending so much time worrying about it? Why does it become so all important to us? It ought to change our attitude toward our furniture, our clothing, our buildings, our cars, our land. Things that we invest our time and our money in. We ought to have a little different perspective knowing that, hey, this is all going to burn up. This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. Oh, that's just a song we sing. We don't really mean that. Is that right? Seeing all these things will be dissolved. All these things are going to burn up. What manner of people, what manner of persons ought ye to be in holy conversation? Conversation in the Bible is your conduct. Not just what you say, but how you live. Your conduct in godliness. Your conduct, of course, is how you live. Your godliness is your attitude. Conduct is the way I live my life. Godliness refers to the attitude I have while I live my life. Peter's saying, I need to be the right kind of person, not just in my behavior, but also in my attitude. You know, you can do the right thing and not have the right spirit. You can do the right actions, but have a horrible attitude while you do it. God is saying here, be holy in action and be godly in your attitudes. Be holy. Be holy. Don't act holy. Be holy. Don't just try to do what you think you should do, but make sure you're being what you ought to be. The return of Christ is to spur us to holy living. But listen, you don't have to do that in your own strength. We don't have to just try harder. Hudson Taylor, the great missionary, said that holiness did not come by striving, but by resting in the Holy One. By the Holy Spirit of God, Jesus Christ has come to live in us. You ever ask yourself this? Why does Jesus come to live in us? There's only one answer. So that He can live through us. That's why He's in us. So He can live through us. Don't miss that. And if you're not allowing Him to live through you, you're missing the point of why He came into you. He came in to live His life through us. Would it be different? Would it be different in your life if Jesus took your place? What if He took your place in your home? How different would things be? What if he went to work and did your job? Not tomorrow, but maybe Tuesday. And He did your job in your place. Would there be much difference? Would anybody notice? What if he sang in your place in the choir or taught in your place in your class? Would anybody notice a difference? How different would life be if Jesus took your place? See, He came to live in me that He might live through me. And through the Spirit of God, I put to death the deeds of the flesh, put to death the deeds of the body, that He might live through me. Remember, one of the most important reasons that Jesus lives in us is so He could live through us. Oftentimes, the problem is we get in the way. And we want our way instead of His way. And we do what we want instead of what God wants to do through us. That hinders holy living. God says, take another look at the world on fire, at the world burning up, and see if that won't put a fire in your heart to live holy, to live godly, and to be holy, and to be godly. So what do we do until the Lord returns? We're to be witnesses. We are to be holy and godly in conduct, in our conversation. And then the third thing we're supposed to be is we're to be looking for His return. We're to be looking for His return. Notice with me again, starting in verse number 12. The first two words of verse 12 are what, church? Looking for. What are they? Looking for, okay? Looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to the promise, what's the next two words? Look for new heaven and new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent, ye may be found of Him in peace, without spot and blameless. Three times in three verses, it talks about looking for something. We're looking for His return. And we're looking forward to His return because that is a sure thing. That is the blessed hope of the believers. It's not a hope Jesus is coming back. I know Jesus is coming back. And we can be confident about that because of what the Bible says. That more than a fourth of the Bible is predictive prophecy. There's full of promises, both the Old and New Testaments, about the return of Jesus Christ. In fact, there's over 1,800 references in the Old Testament. 17 Old Testament books give importance to the theme of the return of Jesus Christ. Of the 260 chapters in the New Testament, there's more than 300 references to the Lord's return. That's about one out of every 30 verses in the New Testament will talk about Jesus coming again. It's an amazing thing. And so if that be true, and by the way, there were over 800 prophecies about the first coming of Christ, and if every one of those were fulfilled and Christ came the first time, why would we doubt He'll come the second time? Why would we doubt the prophecies that He will come again just as the Scripture says He would? Now look at a couple of scriptures with me, would you please? Look at Romans chapter 15. Romans chapter 15. In verse number 10, he says, again he saith, rejoice, ye Gentiles, with His people. And again, praise the Lord, all ye Gentiles, and laud Him, all ye people. And again, Isaiah saith, that's Isaiah, there shall be a root of Jesse, and he that shall rise to reign over the Gentiles, in him shall the Gentiles trust. Now the God of hope fill you with joy and peace. How? In believing, that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. We're talking about the hope we have in Jesus Christ. And it's not just hope for the Jews. It's hope for the Gentiles. In fact, it's hope for all people. Everybody has a hope. The only hope you're going to have is in Jesus Christ. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. And I'm trusting only Jesus Christ. And I'm trusting that He is coming again. That is a blessed hope. Now, I want you to understand something. Hope in the Bible is not the same hope the way we use hope today. Our hope is, we kind of hope it happens, cross my fingers, you know, carry a four-leaf clover in my pocket and put a horseshoe around my neck or something. You know, we do all the things we think, okay, I hope, I wish. That's not the hope of the Bible. We're not saying, I hope, I wish He comes, I hope He'll come. No. The hope in the Bible, in fact, you can look it up. But you know what it says? Confidence in a future event. The highest degree of well-founded expectation. It's a blessed hope. It's a surety. Let me illustrate it for you. Look at Hebrews chapter 6. Go to Hebrews chapter 6. Hebrews 6. Verse Verse number 17 says, wherein God, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath, that by two immutable things, in which it was impossible for God to lie, that we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. We're fleeing here for refuge by laying hold upon the hope that is set before us, which hope we have has an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth in that within the veil, whither the forerunner for us has entered, even Jesus, made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Notice, the hope we have is an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast. That's not a cross your fingers, I hope, I wish. You don't anchor something on that. You anchor it on a sure thing. You anchor on what you know to be true. And what we know to be true is Jesus Christ is coming again. You can rest assured on that. Listen, you can anchor anything. We just sang tonight, Jesus Christ has made to me all I need, all I need. He's all you need. When it comes to salvation, what else do you need? Jesus Christ. When it comes to living your life for Jesus Christ, what do you need? You need Jesus Christ. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Letting Christ live through you. The life that I live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Jesus Christ. He's the anchor that we anchor to and say, he is all I need. And we're anchored in him. F.B. Meyer was a great preacher in England in the late 1800s. He told the story about two Germans who wanted to climb the Matterhorn Mountain in the Alps. They hired three guides and began to climb the steepest and most slippery part. The men were all tied together. Partway up the mountain, the last man lost his footing. He was temporarily held up by the other four because each had a toehold in the ice. But then the next man slipped. And the next. And the next. The only one to stand firm was the first guide who had driven a spike deep into the ice. And because he did, all the other men were saved. And F.B. Meyer concluded by saying, I'm like one of those men who slipped. But thank God, because I'm bound in a living partnership to Jesus Christ, and he stands, I will never perish. I'm anchored to Jesus. And that's the sure hope. He's coming back. He's returning. I don't know if 2017 will be the year. And by the way, the fellow whose book you're reading, he doesn't know either. Okay? And every year guys come up with books. And the fellows who, you understand, when they write a book, they're paid by the publisher to write books. And every so many months, every so many times a year, they have to come out with a book. Well, and the one they wrote 2 years ago didn't happen, so now they got to come up with something new. And I'm just amazed at how many times. Listen, there is a book that was written by someone who knows all about it. And just keep your eyes and your ears in this book, would you? And know that Jesus is going to come back. Be confident about it. But until then, say, what do we do? What do we do? No, what should we be? We should be witnesses. We should be holy. And we should be looking for him to come. We should be looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth here this evening. Lord, I pray you'd help us to be what we ought to be. Lord, you're so concerned that we be what we should be. What manner of persons ought we to be? And Lord, I pray that tonight you'd help us to focus and throughout this year on not just what we're doing, but on what we're being. For if we'll be what we ought to be, we will do what we ought to do. And Lord, I pray that we would be witnesses. I pray that we would be holy, godly. I pray that we would be looking for the return of Jesus. Would be a conscious thought in our mind, a conscious recognition in decisions that we make. We'd be anticipating your return. It's a blessed hope. And we wait for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'll finish praying in just a moment. Wonder how many believers here tonight would say, "Preacher, I want to be what God wants me to be. I don't just want to do what I ought to do. I do want to be what I should be. And I realize I need to be a witness." Some of you, you need to make sure you get some tracts and give them out. You need to be busy warning others, telling others of Christ before it's eternally too late. Be holy. Be godly. In your actions and in your attitudes. Be looking for Him to come. I wonder how many believers tonight would just say, "Preacher, the Lord stopped at my seat tonight and the Spirit of God spoke to my heart. I want to be what I ought to be in 2017. Pastor, pray for me this evening." Would you put your hand up, Christian? Amen. 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 You may put them down. I think the world's looking for people to be what they ought to be. I know God's looking for people like that. Let's be what we ought to be. We'll do what we ought to do. In a moment, I'll pray. Once I pray, we'll have our invitation. God has spoken to your heart tonight. You respond to Him this evening, will you? I wonder, before we pray, anybody here tonight would say, "Pastor, I'm not sure that if the Lord came back, I'm not sure I'd go to be with Him. I don't know for sure that if I died tonight, I'd go to heaven." But Pastor, I appreciate you praying for me about that. Is there anyone like that tonight would say, "Pastor, pray for me," and you slip your hand up and say, "Pastor, I'm not sure I'm saved. Would you pray for me?" I'd be happy to do that. Would you slip your hand up and put it back down? All right. Father, we thank you for speaking to hearts tonight. And Lord, I pray your blessing upon this invitation now. May each one do what you're bidding them to do in their heart. May holy decisions be made for you this evening. And I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart tonight. Respond to Him, will you please?
Oh, to be like Thee, blessed Redeemer,
right.
This is my constant longing and prayer. Gladly I'll forfeit all of earth's treasures, Jesus, Thy perfect likeness to wear. Oh, to be like Thee, oh, to be like Thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as Thou art. Come in Thy sweetness, come in Thy fullness, stamp Thine own image deep on my heart. Oh, to be like Thee, full of compassion, loving, forgiving, tender and kind, helping the helpless, cheering the fainting, seeking the wandering sinners to find. Oh, to be like Thee, oh, to be like Thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as Thou art. Come in Thy sweetness, come in Thy fullness, stamp Thine own image deep on my heart. Oh, to be like thee, lowly in spirit, holy and harmless, patient and brave, meekly enduring cruel reproaches, willing to suffer others to save. Oh, to be like thee, oh, to be like thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as thou art. Come in thy fullness, come in thy sweetness, stamp thine own image deep on my heart.
Go ahead and be seated if you would. Appreciate your attention this evening. And before we get, we're going to take a minute or two here before we pass out the calendars, reveal the theme and everything. Take a few testimonies from the past year, all right? Just some blessing you want to mention from 2016. If you want to go relieve the nursery workers, if you have children down there, go ahead and do that. And would you give me just a little bit more here, Dean? I'm a little weak on my voice. So if you have a nursery child in there, you can get out. Go ahead and do that. We'll let the nursery workers come up and get in on this. We have a couple guys grab the microphones. That way the folks who are watching will be able to hear the testimonies as well. Just want to share something from 2016 that God has been blessing you. Let me share this with you. Maybe this will help a little bit. The Are You Inside program at the prisons, both at the CRC on Thursday and London on Saturday. In 2016, we saw a total of 238 men receive Christ as their Savior at the prison. Isn't that great? Here's a letter I just got yesterday in the mail. He said, at CRC, I started your program, and I had asked Jesus to come into my life. Ever since then, I have not been able to stop reading or studying or thinking about God's Word. And that for the first time, I really feel Him working in my life, and I feel He's looking out for me, even if it's little things. I really want to continue doing the program. I finished my Overcomers book, and I feel I'm ready for my Phase 1 workbook. Thank you, Danny Bryant. And he gives his number here, and he sent in his material. I tell you what, that's worth it right there. You say, where these guys go? Well, there's one of them right there. There's another one right down there. And they're all over. And 238 men in 2016 accepted Christ their Savior. Isn't that great? Men, sometimes when it's tough to go on Thursday or tough to go on Saturday, just remember that. Remember what God's doing. It's a great, great work. And praise the Lord for that. All right. Who wants to start us off in our testimonies tonight here? Who we got? Susan? Do it quickly. We want to just get through these real quick, okay?
I just want to thank the Lord for, you know, giving me a church-worthy family and a godly husband, because if it weren't for me turning back to the Lord, I don't know what I would do.
Amen. Amen. God bless you, Susan. That's great. All right. Somebody else? Go quickly. Bill, back in the back. Leanne, up here. Got to start the year off praising God, all right? Leanne, go ahead. The microphone right there, Leanne.
Thank you. Some of you heard this at RU, maybe, but wanted all of you to hear it because at Christmas dinner, on Christmas Day, my sister, whose house we were at, Kim, she said to everybody, well, who's going to pray over dinner? And I automatically said, well, I will. She said, no. She said, somebody else needs to do it. So then my other sister, who was the one who told me I could not read the Christmas story when I was at her house, she said, I will, and she prayed. And then when I was looking around my sister's house, she had a picture of Jesus up, and my mother's manger was out. And it was just such a good feeling to see them moving toward the Lord. So don't give up. If somebody's not moving as quick as you want them to, don't give up. The Amen. Lord is working.
Amen. That's good. Amen. Good. Bill?
Yeah, I just want to thank the Lord for a year of opening my eyes to many things and many challenges I know he has for me in growth. And I'm just thankful for a place and opportunity to do that here Amen. At Bible Baptist Church.
Appreciate your service, Brother Bill. Faithfully drives the bus every week and works with the RU Kids program. And he's one of the Saturday morning London fellas out there every Saturday morning serving the Lord there. That's good. Amen. Oh, down here.
I just want to praise the Lord for everything he's doing in my life. I sit back last night at home and I thought about being out with friends and different people that I used to associate with. And I thought, like, where my life used to be and how much better it is now that I've come to start coming to church and start serving the Lord. My life is so much better. And RU did that for me, being in the prison. And I look at my life, and I'm just amazed how it's going in a good direction.
Amen.
And I love you guys, and I thank you for being my family and everything you do for me.
Amen. That's great. Thanks, Alan. Amen. All right. You're pointing balance to you. Oh, right in the front row.
I'd just like to thank the Lord for my past year. I lost my wife and my best friend who took care of our wedding passed away. This lady right next to me, we go to the same church. She lost her father. And she was in the hospital with septic infection. And wow. SID level was her. The Lord was with her. He's been with me through this whole year. Our church had a service this morning, and we are here because of the Lord. We love God, and we just seen this church, and we thought there's a lot of cars were following God.
Well,
I'd like to thank God for everything in my life.
Great. Great to have you tonight.
It's been a good
That's
year,
wonderful.
Too.
Well, great. Thanks for coming.
It's been
Thanks
a good year to have
in.
God on
Amen.
Our side through all of this.
Thank you. Amen. Amen. That's wonderful. It's good. Brenda.
I want to praise God because I'm still here. I'm still alive. I suffered a mild heart attack and two minor heart attacks on top of that. And I'm still here and kicking. And I'm able to be here for my kids.
All right.
And I also wanted to praise him because I know where I'm going if something happens to
Amen.
Me.
Amen, Brenda. Glad you're here. Thanks for coming tonight. That's good. Amen. All right. Anyone else? Get in on it. All right. If that's all, that's all. That's it. Ann Moreland, there she is. Hold on. Your husband's coming. He's running towards you as we speak. Amen.
Now, I just want to praise the Lord for last year. It was a wonderful year Amen. From Armenia to Uganda to having a brand new granddaughter and getting our plane tickets. And this year, we're looking forward to getting on our new mission field and yeah. praise God for that.
Amen. Amen. That's good. 2017 will be a big year.
And she left out Mexico.
Jim Talladay. Get a mic to Jim Talladay right here, please.
Who's he? Jim.
Uh-huh.
I no thank God for my salvation, this church, and my family.
Amen.
75 years of
yep.
good life.
Amen. Jim's birthday was New Year's Eve, December 31st. 75 years young. And amen. Appreciate the Talladays and their faithfulness. That's great. All right?
I'll say something, Pastor.
Okay, Danny. And then Diane had her hand up. Okay.
I just want to thank God for leading my wife and I to this church. We came on a big day. It was a turkey dinner day, and somebody knocked on our door, and we weren't living right at the time, and they asked us if we wanted to come to a turkey dinner. And we were starving. both mentally and physically, spiritually. And we came here and been coming ever since. And you know, God is, he's a great God.
Amen. Amen.
I love you guys too. You guys are all the family we really have. And I'm so grateful that the Lord has put these ministries in our lives. It's a blessing to go to London every Saturday morning. And I tell the guys, if someone was to show up and offer me a briefcase full of money, if I wouldn't go in. I wouldn't take it.
Amen.
Because I get to see these guys' lives transform right in front of us. And God is an amazing God.
Amen.
And he does great things. And if you're not serving him, you need to serve him.
Amen.
Because he'll take you places you never knew existed.
Amen.
And I just praise him for that.
Amen. Amen. That's great. Praise the Lord, man. And Saturday mornings at London, and also Sundays, the first Sunday, second Sunday, and the fifth Sunday of every month, they heads up the nursing home ministry as well. And several of the folks here involved with that. They had 16 today at the nursing home, and do that on Sunday afternoon.
And I just want to say that that's not something we have to do. It's something we get to do.
Amen. Amen.
We get to serve Jesus, Amen. And that's the best thing in the world.
Amen. Diane.
Well, I've had a little bit of a difficult year this year. Mm-hmm. What some people may think. But I've seen a lot of prayers answered. I've seen a lot of love from my church family. Like Danny says, this is my family. I don't have much family other than this. But I've never seen so many prayers answered on my behalf and so many people that prayed for Amen. Me this year. I'm thankful for that.
Amen. Amen. That's good. Hey, I want to ask one thing. If you had surgery of any kind this year, I want you to stand up. Stand up. Surgery of any kind this year, stand up. God brought you through. Look at that. Look at that.
Amen.
God's a good God, isn't he?
Great
Amen.
God.
Amen. Give him a hand. That's great. Amen.
Heather.
Carol, no one's going to hear you, but okay, all right. Lord will bring you through that. Who we got? Heather Joy?
I'm grateful for in 2016, I had actually several opportunities to witness to my dad. And recently, I was able to, like, really spell it all out. He was kind of maybe debating a few points. But now he's been sending me some Christian things or Christian literature articles because he's very much into history. And I just think that that's just another step in the right direction that Amen. Every time I get to go see him, it's just another step that he sees the support that I have, you know, with church family, and that makes a big difference. So, Amen. And just everything the Lord has blessed me with this past year, and I look forward to more.
Praise the Lord. Good. Amen. Good. Amen. All right. Did that do it? Okay. Come on up, fellas. And how are you going to do this theme, Bob? Where's Bob? Oh, just I guess we'll get ready to pass out the calendars first, fellas, probably. And you go ahead and just, no, you can undo the theme. I think most of y'all, how old, anybody know what it is? What manner of persons? Go ahead. Ought ye to be. The theme, that's not the whole theme now. The theme, make it easy on you. Just remember, be. We're going to focus on what we ought to be. Focus on what we ought to be. What manner of verse? You're going to hear different verses all year long about be. You know, the Bible's full of them. Dozens and dozens of verses about what we ought to be. We'll be unpacking those on Wednesday nights and such here coming up, all right? Calendars, and I would like one. If you guys pass them out. How do we do it normally, do you know? One. Yeah, give one for a family for right now. Great job on the calendar. Brother Bob put this together. If you see any mistakes, it's all his fault. But hopefully we got Grace's birthday on this one. She'll check that out first thing, I'm sure. I should have checked that out. What is it, June 18th? March 18th. Oh, it's on here. Good. All right, everybody got it? You notice every month you have a different verse. This month it's be not conformed to this world, be transformed. February, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. March, be perfect, be of good comfort, be of one mind, live in peace. April, it is good to be zealously affected, always in a good thing. May, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. June, that ye may be sincere and without offense until the day of Christ. July, but ye, brethren, be not weary in well-doing. August, be thou partakers of the afflictions of the gospel. September, that ye be not slothful. October, be doers of the word. November, to be spiritually minded is life and peace. And in December, be thou faithful unto death. All right. On the back, you have the weekly opportunities. And then, of course, all the ministries are listed, as well as our missionaries here at the start of 2017. Good thing for your prayer time. All right. Now, let me tell you. This is what, can I help you? Will you listen? Amen. This is what you revolve your life around. When people want to do something, or they schedule something, you say, let me check the calendar. So you don't miss things that you know are important and you need to be here for. Okay? That's why it's done a year ahead of time. So when there's something coming up, you don't say, oh, so-and-so asked us to go to their house. Well, did they ask you January 1st? If not, this was first. And really, if you revolve your life around the local church, you'll never regret it. You'll never regret it. And so just build your life around that. Schedule your vacations around it so you don't miss any special meetings, revivals, or special services. It'll help you. Okay, so keep that handy. Put it up somewhere where you see it. And there's a lot of blanks, so you can fill it. We didn't fill it up with the normal weekly things, so you can write different things in on the calendar, and it'll be a great help to you, okay? That's a beautiful job, Brother Bob. Thank you for doing that. Okay? Now we have a directory that everybody can, again, one per family for the directory. And if you're not in the directory and you want to be, make sure you see Mrs. Wallace, and she'll make sure she gets you in there. And we're going to give you a pen. Bible Baptist Church, Grove City, it has phone number, the web address, and the theme for 2017, B-E, all right? I thought that'd get yellow, it'd match the auditorium, you know? Everybody got it? Bob, are we ready next door? Do you have any idea? All right, everybody get what you need? All right, we're going to have a word of prayer here for the food next door. You're welcome to stay. I'm sure we have plenty. Just remember there's people who are coming behind you, okay, and get something. But it's not once everybody gets through once, if you want to come back up and get some more, you can. I'm sure there'll be some that way. But remember that. Children, go through with mom and dad, okay? And mom and dad, watch what your children put on their plate, okay? There's times I've seen kids and they've got 6 cookies and 3 pieces of pie and something else and then end up throwing it away because they didn't eat it all. So be aware of that, okay? I just don't want to be wasteful and just want to be a good steward, okay? Well, we'll get everybody through, get you sat down, and then we'll start the pictures and give the year in review. Okay. Oh, if you didn't get your 3x5 card of anybody on the prayer list, if you didn't get that filled out and turned in, get that filled out and turned in. There's 3x5 cards right there in the back on that table right by the door. Fill that out and give it to Kay. Put it on the counter in the office. We'll get it. But we want to make sure that we're going to be updating that prayer list on Wednesday night. And if you want, keep the request on there. We're happy to do that, but we need to hear from you for that, okay? All right. Let's stand together. We'll have a word of prayer, and we'll go next door and have some food and fellowship and some slides, all right, or pictures, whatever it is these days, all right? Father, thank you for this evening. Thank you, Lord, for our church family. Thank you, God, for your goodness to us through this last year. And thank you for the souls that have been saved and the lives that have been reached, the folks have been healed from various diseases, and you've safely brought through different surgeries. You're a great God. Lord, we love you tonight. We thank you so much for what you have done. And Lord, we're excited and looking forward to what you are going to do in this new year. Lord, many exciting things are going to happen in 2017. The Morelands will go to their mission field. The Parax will take their first missions trip over to Russia, and Lord, Brother Yoder will be traveling and holding meetings and doing pastors' conferences. And Lord, it's just it's an exciting time to be serving you. Thank you for what you are doing here in our midst. And I pray, God, you continue to have your hand of blessing upon Bible Baptist Church. Bless our fellowship tonight. Bless the food. Bless our time together. May it be an enjoyable time for your church tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you next door. You want to sing something? Let's sing "It's a Grand Thing to Be a Christian" while you're going out, all right? Here we go. Hey, it's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you.